Welcome everybody to the Saturday webinar. And I wanna say I'm happy to be with all of you today. We had a couple of hiccups, that's why we're starting a little bit late, but it's all good now. It's all working. Angie took care of it. Hi, Angie. Hi, Jim. And I wanna say hello to everybody here. In the group, and we have Blue, Christine, Damien, Khan, Malaba, Sam, Shaheen, Sheer, Valerie, and of course myself. And then with Jim, we have Angie. Who else do we have with you, Jim?
We have Barbara and Ray also.
Hello.
Hi there.
Hello, everybody.
Hello, everybody.
So, it's sort of a rainy, cold morning, so we don't have a lot of people here today.
Okay.
That's the way it is here.
All righty then.
So, before we do anything else, Marla, before we do anything else, we would like to start with a prayer or a blessing, however you would like to call it. So Jim, would you like to do the honors?
Oh, okay. Yes, I was asking earlier if somebody wanted to do the blessing. So, okay, I'll do it.
Okay.
One moment, please. Thank you. Thank you, Mother, Father, God, for this opportunity to come together and share information, share love, share with the community, share all the things that we are together with one another, connect our souls together and make beautiful light. We just ask that you be with us now and guide us on our paths. Give us some information that we really need or that is important for us. There is so much information that's coming in these days, and we need to know what's going on. So thank you very much, and we praise you and thank you for all that you do for us. Amen.
Thank you. Amen. Thank you for that. And I also want to say thank you for all the people that watch us, that listen, that come, that go to Jim's house, and for all the light that is being brought into this world by us changing and becoming more of ourselves and becoming more self-aware. So,
thank you.
On that note, I want to say we love you, Jim, and we will let you go now and see who comes. You know, someone that it's a service to others. If it's not Kenjin, who can talk to us about first contact.
Okay, very good. Thank you, everybody. I know I haven't been here for quite a while, so thank you for coming. It's a pleasure to be here again, and I'm happy to do the webinar today. And thank you all for your support. Thank you. So many of you have written notes to me about my dad, and he's in a way better place now, and he's looking down on us today. So he, as well as my mom, so they're both there. So I'm an orphan. Oh. But anyway, no, I'm not. But they're lovely people, and they had a lovely life, and I'm so glad that they're in paradise. So thank you for all your kind wishes, thoughts, and prayers. So today we're going to talk about disclosure first contact. So I know that Kenjin is already here, so we might as well bring him in first. So let me do a little bit of a meditation, and we'll bring him in, and then whoever else wants to come in after that. Very good. One moment.
Very good. Thank
Prepare
you.
Prepare your questions. He has a lot of answers, I guess. Greetings, people of Earth. I am Kenjin, ruling king of Erra.
Welcome, Kenjin.
Thank you. Thank you for calling me for this occasion. I do have information that might be valuable to you. Of course, you know about the John Podesta email leaks about different alien things. Like one of those things was about not having any weapons in space. And another thing was about talking about the wars that exist in the galaxy. So they are aware of these things. So many other species and people on your planet are aware of all the different things that were exposed in these particular email links. What I would like to do is add to that information. They are very general for the most part, and they do not really go into detail, because the reason they do have a little detail, but not as much as you would need to understand what they're really talking about. Now, the thing about that is they know all the details, and so when writing emails one to another, they do not need to go into detail to inform each other what's going on in this situation. They are just reminding each other that this has come up and that these things are being discussed once again. Is that clear? So there are many other things in there that are general. But what I would like to talk about, they do not really discuss a date or time when your first contact is going to happen. And the reason for that is because they do not know at this point. It is not just a matter of the United States being involved in this decision. It's a worldwide decision. And so therefore they cannot make any predictions at this time. But they can know that the people of the Earth are now becoming much more aware that first contact is coming. When taken polls, over 85% of the people on your planet believe in aliens or believe that there is such a thing. And about 70% thinks that the government, or actually 72 to 74%, is that the governments know about them and are not saying anything. So there are many people out there that do not talk about first contact or do not talk about anything about aliens at all, but are aware that they do exist and are aware that they are there. So it is becoming very clear that first contact must come fairly soon. So therefore, I have an echo, I think. Therefore, you must understand that the rest of the world must be clued in on these things while there is time. What I mean by that is there are many people who do believe that in aliens, but believe that they are negative, believe that they are actually demons, or actually negative beings of some sort, because many of your religions, spiritual people teach that there is no such thing as a spiritual alien, but that you are the only people in the galaxy, universe, etc., that have a spirituality, which is untrue. They believe that the spirituality of all those people outside of your Earth are negative, but this is not true. They are aware that they exist, and they call them aliens or demons or Satans, but they do not believe that they are positive. So this is a big point that I wanted to get across. Even though many of your people believe in aliens, there is a good percentage that believes that they are negative. And also, the cabal and other different facets of your society want you to believe that they are negative. They put negativity in the movies about aliens. They make aliens look bad in all respects that they can and make them look sneaky, underhanded, and hateful. So therefore, yes, although many of your people do believe in aliens, many of them believe they are negative and would not want them to come to your planet, let alone have a first contact with your people. This thought process must be changed to a certain degree before first contact can happen. And so therefore, we are working on that with some positive alien views. If you will notice in your last Independence Day movie, there were positive aliens also, not just negative aliens. So there are some things coming out now that are exposing the fact that although there are negative aliens, and we will admit that, there are now evidences in the populace that there are positive aliens as well. Right now, the chances of a first contact are slim for this particular year and for next year. But within the next 7 years or 6 years, it gets better. The thing is, this election will shake up many thoughts and processes about looking at life differently. This is something that needs to happen for you to your peoples of your Earth to change their thought processes about many things. Many also will change their ideas about how religion should be viewed, and if there are negative aliens or positive aliens, what should happen with that? The very fact that this election in the United States, which is a major player in the world economy and world political, is going to be a very different kind of election and already has been, but will definitely make people think and wonder about what is good and what is evil. There is many lies being told, but there's many truths that are also negative. So therefore, you will have to deal with what you believe is the truth and what you believe is not. Do you understand this? First of all, there are lies on both sides of the aisle, as it is called. But there is so much riding on who gets into this office. But unfortunately, neither one will make much of an impact because of what will be happening after that. Now, let's go back to first contact. First of all, I am so happy that all of you are wanting first contact, craving it even, and are wanting to go to colonies, know more about aliens, and actually have relationships with friendly, beautiful, and spiritual aliens. This is a wonderful thing. And I know not everyone on your planet believes that they are positive. They believe that they are trying to fool you in some way or have hidden agendas. Of course, every single person has a hidden agenda. Even if you don't want to admit it, you are not an open book. There are things that you hide from each other. But in this case, all the hidden agendas in the alien point of view have nothing to do with you. They have only to do with themselves and their own species. So therefore, do not worry about how they are looking at you. Do not worry about how they are feeling about you, because you are a deep concern for them, according to the prophecies of the galaxy and universe. You come into view as a very important part. Maybe not right this second, but it is actually starting. I will add that. But as you continue to move in the ascension and your evolution, you will become a greater part of the cure, the problem with the galaxy. I know there are a lot of questions out there. I think this is a good time to start them.
Hello, Kenjin.
Hello.
So, I want to start by saying thank you for coming. This is very important, though. I know that right now, what's happening here on Earth takes precedence over anything else. What's happened is that along with that, of course, information is coming out with has brought up the contact and the awareness that the government has about extraterrestrials. So I would start with, has there been talks of when is this best to happen, or has this been halted due to the turmoil that it's happening right now with different countries?
It depends on who you talk to and what country that you're in. There are, in the United States, there are those that are willing to discuss it. There are those that are willing to bring forth processes about it, but there are others who are not. The reason being that the southern states, the Bible Belt, would be very much influenced by the fact that aliens would be accepted, and they do not accept aliens as a positive group of people. Therefore, your governments, there's certain people in the governments that would rather not expose aliens at this time, especially as a friendly group, because they know that this would put their political lives in jeopardy. Countries such as Russia, China, Japan, there are mixed views there as well. And it depends on who you speak to, what outcome is what they want. But they really, in Japan, they don't really care. They're firmly apathetic about aliens at this point. They don't speak about them. They don't talk about them. They know that they exist. The people know that they exist. But they go about their third dimensional lives, and they don't really speak about them. And there are very few people that would really want a first contact, because that just means their lives would be interfered with, and they would be taken away from their prime focus, which is the third dimension, making money, being successful, and raising families, blah, all these different things. There are different sections of China that are in different readiness for first contact. The northern part of China is ready for contact, because they see the spaceships and different aliens more frequently than the rest of the country, because it is not as populated, it is not as, there's not as many cities, and there is more activity there when it comes to coming and going of the ships. Also, the center part of the country would also be a little bit more open. When you get to the east, west, and south borders, there are more people there around Kazakhstan and things of that nature, around the Hong Kong area and the coast area, that are more third dimensional in their thought processes and may not want to see aliens come. But I would say that at least 40% of China is aware and ready for first contact, maybe even a higher percentage of that. Now, Russia, they are all very aware of aliens and all different kinds of aliens. They were very much inundated with reptilians at one time, but Putin has now put that to a halt. He's actually pushed the aliens out of their office areas and their control areas to some extent. He was controlled by them for a while, but now he sees what damage that they were doing, and so he is done an about face in some terms. Not that he is a great person and wanting good for the world, but that he's doing better by his people, his country, and what he's seeing. But he is not one that would shun a war. He is actually would want a war on a global way, because he feels that he could have a greater influence on all the things that are happening on your planet. He is a very confident person and has good leadership abilities whenever he's in control. Now, is that enough information about that for now?
Yes, Khan had asked, what is the role of Turkey in first contact or the Middle East?
The Middle East is not worried about first contact. Their primary objective is jihad and to maintain their religious rites and activities. They do not believe that aliens should be any part of this planet. So they are not really looking to have a very big, except for Israel. Israel is an exception to the rule. They do believe in aliens, and they would welcome them if they came on their terms. Other countries would not welcome them. They have too much to lose. They have too much to defend, and they're already defending themselves in great ways already. They do not want to have another person as an enemy. And they would look at aliens as an enemy because they would be taking perhaps some of their prestige or money, or taking over power that they would want. And they are a fear-based people. So you must understand, everything that is of the unknown is actually a fear-based thought process.
Okay, Omran had a question.
Yes.
Yes, hello, Kenjin.
Greetings.
Nice to meet you.
Greetings. Nice to meet you.
My questions are also about first contact.
Very well.
I believe we are all aware that there are inner Earth alliances in a garden.
Yes. Yes.
Shouldn't they be contacting us first, because they are a part of the planet? Shouldn't they come first before outer extraterrestrials? Aren't they first ones we should contact?
Yes, I understand what you're saying. The reason why they are under the Earth is because of the nature of who they are. They are people that do not want to talk to humans or to be a part of the human race. Otherwise, they would have done that already centuries ago. They actually want to separate themselves from, and even when first contact comes, many of them will not show themselves until much later. You see, they're still very much in a place of thought where they want to maintain their rituals, their traditions, and who they are. They do not want to mingle with the people of the Earth. And so they have kept themselves as private as possible. And yes, they would be probably, they have been seen by many people also, but they did not wish that to happen. Probably because they know the Earth so well, not the surface as much, but the internal workings of the Earth and where they live and things, would be interested in perhaps sharing their thoughts with the world, but they actually do not see that as something that it would be beneficial to them. They see it as being harmful to their society. So they see what humans are like, and they do not really want to interact with them. So it is a matter of their free choice of wanting to interact with humans rather than it being a logical choice. Do you understand that?
Yes, I do. It's just very confusing because Corey Good, who is in contact with the Inner Earth Alliance, said in one of his articles that the Inner Earth Alliance wants to contact us before the aliens does. And this is not all of them, of course, but some of them, some of the races wants to meet us before.
Yes, I've heard of this. They did. There is an alliance with a few different species that are living under the planet that wouldn't mind contacting the Earth. Now, keep in mind this, because they are an alliance, they feel a little safer with their numbers. Do you understand? They feel a little safer, but they are still not in agreement that they should contact humans. Now, I'm glad you brought up the fact that some of them do want to contact humans because they have met certain ones that are helpful or seem good, kind, and they are now becoming more aware of how much humans do know about aliens and about other species. And so this is piquing their curiosity, but they still see a chance. They still see it as a risk. Even though they say they are wanting to do so, there are many in their populace that are fighting against it. There are those that are speaking out that think that it is a very good idea, but they are not by far the population or the majority. They are by far the minority.
Yes, okay, I understand that. And one little quick question. I know that they are trying to contact us, contact some of us, the Inner Earth people. And one of them came to me last night. I don't know if they want to involve me in some kind of first contact thing. I felt that that was needed, but it was not clear.
Let me tell you how they're going about this. Those that are wanting to contact humans are contacting humans one-on-one. Now, the reason for this is because they know who is good, and they're bringing back information to the populace and to the alliance that these people are good. These people have good hearts and are good to contact and can help us or be in a good friendship with us and perhaps help us to be more understood by the population of the outer world, as they call it. And so, yes, those people that are in fact wanting to move out onto the planet and make contact with the planet are making individual contacts. This is their first step. And they're bringing information back to the population, to the alliance, that these people are good. And these contacts can perhaps help us to be more understood, to be more accepted. And this is a very big thing for them. They know that you know they're there. There's no question about that. They know that you know they're there. They just don't know who will accept them. Believe that everyone will. And this is true at this point. And so they are making their first moves with individuals and those that are accepting of them and those that understand that they are good and that they are a positive group. Does that make sense to you?
Yes, that does it. Yes. Well, I'm very happy to help them and help the human project, Earth project.
Yes, they are very happy that there are those that they can come to, especially those that are really looking for a slow movement into your world. Now, you see, their first contact would not be like an off-world first contact. Their first contacts would be gradual and slow moving, if you know what I mean. They would not just, boom, there they are. They are contacting individuals. They're getting to know groups, small groups of people. Then they will move into larger groups. They have a way that they want to do it to make themselves in a very subtle way, but then in a very real way as well.
Okay, thank you very much. That was it.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Sure. It was good speaking to you.
Hello, Your Majesty.
Ah, Sheer, how are you?
I'm very well. How are you?
Well, as you may know.
First off, I was wondering if it's possible to send my name to those beings in the inner Earth that are interested in taking humans.
Yes, possible. Actually, they know who you are, but they have no portals that close by you that to come out of. The populations that are closest to you are under the water.
Okay. My question is about Plan B. I know that the Girk Fitneer has a limited time until 2020 to achieve first contact, and if not, other parties will get involved. Can you say something about that?
There are already other... All right, let me say this. Yes, Girk Fitneer has put together a program to be the first contact group. At least in their eyes, it is a very positive and very looking to be successful group, where the Yahyel will be the first to be contacting the Earth with humans with them, etc., etc. There's a very large contingency of ideas. I don't know if that's the right word, but there is a large group of ideas that they have, and they're discussing them. And there is a group of people, a group of Girk Fitneerians that are working on this first contact idea. They know that it's not quite time yet. However, having said that, there are also other species that are looking to make a first contact as well on their own, not part of the Girk Fitneer Alliance. They believe that they have the better ideas, they have the better way to do it, and they would be more or democratic or whatever the word is that they are going to use. So there are many out there, and now, as people and those off-worlders are becoming aware of each other's plans, they are now coming together to discuss it as a group. And so there are some discussions with several different species and alliances about first contact. And of course, you may understand, there is no agreement about what to do and how it should be done. At this point, there are four ideas about first contact that are being discussed primarily, but there are at least seven ideas that are still on the table.
I see. And is there any other meeting, like the one in Alpha Centauri a couple months ago?
Yes, that also mentioned first contact. That meeting was brought together, but not primarily for first contact. However, it was for interplanetary political alliances and discussions, trade agreements, etc. But also it was mentioned about first contact, and there was discussion about that at that particular meeting.
Okay, and is there another one scheduled?
Oh, of course. They have those meetings periodically.
Ah, okay, but not something special.
Not, that one was sort of special because it was out of alignment with their regular schedule. But, and it, there was a couple trade agreement items that were on the table that had not been there before. And so they had to discuss that. Plus, travel has changed in that portion of space a little bit. They're making some breakthroughs on how to travel more safely and without as much problems. So they were discussing that and how to share that information in a safe way, because they did not want all that information to be shared with lower intellectual groups, that could, it could be a problem for them to know these things, because it does include some high powered equipment.
Okay, thank you very much, and it was great to speak with you again.
Thank you, and great to speak with you as well.
Liz, you're next.
Greetings, is there someone there?
Liz, is she here? Okay.
It does not appear that anyone is speaking.
Okay. Can you speak, Liz? All right, then you're next, Melibar.
Who?
You are next. Go ahead.
Who, Melibar?
Yes, you.
Hi. My question is about, hi, first of all. My question is about the Yahyel. What are they supposed to teach us or educate us for our true history?
You mean because they are chosen for first contact?
Correct. They're those who first to come. That's their real name. Their old name is Shalanaya.
The reason they are chosen, first of all, let me get to the basis of why they were chosen. First of all, they were chosen because their DNA is 97.7% or somewhere in that area of human DNA. And they are starting and do look more human and friendly looking than some of the other species. Plus the fact that they will be bringing human correspondence with them, humans that will also help people to understand that they are not negative. Of course, there are other species out there that look human, but these will actually be humans that they are bringing with them for first contact. What the 𝗪𝗄𝗁 plan to do with first contact is bring a very friendly presence and a very calm presence to first contact, that some species may not have that that look, that they could create a calm sensation. Like if reptilians were to come first, people would be frightened. Even with 𝗪𝗄𝗁 or any other species, they would be frightened. But 𝗪𝗄𝗁 look the kindest, the friendliest, and will be able to speak to them in a very calm way and let them know that the reason they are here is to be friends and to make the Earth part of the neighborhood in the galaxy, the universe, etc. This is a gesture of friendship, to join another group that is very, that has trillions of people in it. Aliens are multi-trillions. So they're just going to make the offer to become part of who they are, to join with them, to just be part of the political neighborhood of the galaxy, not to change your planet, not to make any changes in your politics, not to make any changes in your belief systems. They just want to be known, people to know they exist, that they are friendly, they are offering a handshake or a helping hand to become closer united with those that are all around them.
Any idea where this first contact will be, where and when?
Well, where they're discussing where and when constantly. At this point, they have decided that there will be at least 12 contact points, meaning that it will seem like a small invasion, but it's not. They'll put your minds to rest immediately that is not why they are here. But they want to make sure that everyone knows that they are coming. And it has been discussed that perhaps 12 contact points is too many, and some say it's not enough. And some say that one contact point with a very large ship would probably be the best way to go, but they are still discussing this. So many, many thoughts about that.
Wasn't the first contact in Phoenix, Arizona in 1997?
But that was not a first contact universally. It was just a first contact that was very, very small. And that would not be considered a first contact, but just a chance meeting.
One more question, last question. What is the difference between the jinn mentioned in the Quran and the insan, which means humans? What's the difference there?
I did not hear. Could you repeat the question?
There is a concept, a word in the Quran, Islamic holy book, says it talks about the jinns and the humans. Yes. What's the difference? Are you part of a jinn, the aliens?
Jinn are alien. However, they have made their life on Earth. The jinn come from a different place, of course. But they were very fond of humans and were very giving and generous to humans. And the jinn is like what you would call a genie in the lamp or whatever. They're very magical, very mystical, and there's very few of them left on your planet. But they are there. They are still on your planet and still inhabit some areas. But they are very loving to humans. Unless you make them upset, then they can be quite dangerous. However, for the most part, they think of your people as sort of like pets in some ways, because, oh, they're so cute and sweet. And, you've been a bad dog, so but they don't really look at you as that intelligent of a species. So the jinn is there, but they have come, they are very, very advanced, and they're very kind and wonderful, but they really do not look at humans in the right perspective, in my mind. They're so far advanced that they can't bring themselves down that far.
And also, there's also the word or concept of Iblis in the Quran. Who's that, and
what is it?
Iblis, his name is Iblis, is the almost the was a an angel who
yes, there are angels and there are species that are angelic in some ways.
But Iblis, who is he supposed to be?
It just refers to a being that appeared when the Quran was being written. I do not know what species it was, but it was not human. And so they put it in there because they figured it was meant to be that a godlike being visited. And that was a good sign for them that this was, they were on the right track when they were writing the Quran.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hello, Kenjin. So what Liz was asking, she said if about 300 people knowing about and welcoming alien entities, would it be possible for this group together in a village, oh, guys, please stop typing, to evoke or ask for a mass landing? Would it be all right? Hold on. Would it be all right for it to come together in a chosen place and await a landing and physical contact with aliens?
Actually, on your planet, this has happened many times. Just to let you know, there are groups of people from the far past to the present that have come together and invoked a landing or asked for a landing. It has not always happened, but there have been a few times when this has happened. Now, for this to happen, there would be no photographs, no discussion of this outside of the group, because that is the rules for this particular kind of landing. But they will benefit greatly by this landing. And so, yes, if you have a group that is like this, you will at least see the saucers or the ships or the orbs that are around. They will allow you to at least do that. But if there's anyone in the group they do not approve of, they will not land. They will scan the group and find all thoughts of positivity and negativity and different things. They will find about backgrounds and foregrounds and things of this nature. And if there's one in the group that they do not like, they would have to either leave or that the landing would not happen.
Okay. Thank you, Kenji. Raymond, it's next.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Sabrina.
Raymond, he is in the room here.
Yeah, because we're talking about first contact, and we just witnessed a new species being shown to us in public eye. What can you tell us at this time about the Ellii?
The Ellii are a very advanced dimensional species. They are very aware of many things on Earth, but they have not been here for a long, long time, and now they have re-entered your space. Usually they come in through portholes. They're almost considered angelic because of their kind and thoughtful nature, but they are not. But they are very good beings. They enter through portholes. They do not travel in ships until they get here. And then if they want to travel on the planet or around the planet, they use orbs. They are very advanced. They are very interested in human physiology. They are very interested in healing humans, which is interesting. Because not all species that come to your society are interested in these kinds of things. I am aware of the Ellii now for several, and I knew that they were coming, but I did not know when. But they had sent out information throughout the galaxies, I say galaxies plural, about 17 galaxies are aware of where they are at this time. But they are here on Earth to help with the ascension, with healing humans that are to be the future, and to make them feel better and give them a greater sense of confidence and greater amount of energy for their missions.
That is all.
Thank you.
On that note, Kenjin, so if anyone that has any illness would like to contact them. Is there anything in particular they should say or do?
Well, actually, there are two different entities that are interested in healing. Well, Girk Fitneer also has a medical officer, which does much work on with the humans. But the Eliyaha and the Eli are much more advanced. And those two different, the Eliyaha is a community-based group, which is very godlike and one step under a god, as the Elohim and the El are. And the Eli, which also has the god in front of their name, is more of a slightly lower than them, but are learning a great deal. They work together at some times with the Elia to perform mental operations on the brain to improve thought processes, remove headaches, especially migraines, to heal all kinds of mental disorders.
All right, thank you. David, it's next. David, are you here?
Are you there?
Yes, I just had to unmute. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, good. Yes.
Continue.
Hello, good to talk to you. I was wondering, I'm pretty close to a portal and you guys were talking about contact. Is it possible for anyone to visit at the portal where I will be living nearby?
I'm not sure of all what you said, but I believe you're asking if there will be alien contact near the portals where you live. Is that correct?
Yes, if it's possible where I could meet someone there, since there's a portal so close.
Yes, that is possible. That is depending on who the species is that is coming to those particular portals. I'm aware of where you are talking about now. Yes, there mostly right now, there are Native American Indians from the past in that area. Also, they have met with aliens many times in the past, mostly in the early 1900s of your centuries. Yes? Continue. There will be times when there will be ships there. You will have to find them. They will not be looking for you. They are there for the energy of the vortexes.
Just go in there every now and then and look around and invite them in?
Yes. Remember, some of them will be fourth dimensional and you will not be able to see them without the help of the vortexes. So, and fifth dimensional craft are also there, but very few third dimensional crafts will come because they have, there is a reason for that, but I cannot go into it right now. It would take too long to explain.
Do a lot of meditating in that area and feel free to invite.
Yes, you're talking about the 16 layered vortex. Is that correct?
Yeah, I don't know which one is which. I don't know how to look. I'll
There's
maybe
a
find out.
Layer, and the other one fluctuates. Eight. Yes, there's an eight layer vortex, but that one fluctuates. The 16 layer vortex does not.
How do I tell which one's the 16?
It will seem much more steady and calm.
Okay. Beautiful. Any other things about the portals and the history of that area that would be really good to
know? There is much rich history right there. And with the help of the vortexes, you can go there and bring the history back to your brain. It will come to you. You'll see children playing. You'll see the Indians, the campfires, you'll see the entire civilization. It is still there in spirit form.
Beautiful. Thank you.
Because of the vortexes, you will be able to see what has happened there in the past.
Oh, okay.
You will also be probably able to see the alien contacts that they have made.
In what way do you mean that I would be able to see in meditation or?
The vortexes enhance fourth dimensional energy. There's tons of fourth dimensional energy on your planet these days with the anomaly. However, this will make it more precise and bring it into a generalized area.
Okay, good. Thank you. That's awesome.
Yes. Very interesting. Very unusual.
Did you?
Krella?
Oh. Oh, never mind.
Krella, you're next?
Yes.
Krella. Greetings.
Yes. I wanted to ask about the structure on Erra. How is the society structured? How does it function?
That is a large answer. But first of all, I am the king of Erra, and I do have a political party underneath me. I have a ruling government that helps me with my kingship. That I am not alone. I do make the final decisions. However, there are many that give their comments and their thought processes about each item that would come up in our political arena. Also, there is another class of governors under that rule very large areas of the planet. Then under that, there are those that are just social directors, in the sense that people can go to them and find out what is happening, or make complaints, or give ideas that will be fed up into the hierarchies of the governments. There is police in some areas of the planet, but not in all areas. We had just gotten over a war, and in those areas for the next, what you would call 18 months, there will be police guarding that area so that no activity happens that is negative.
Okay, and I have one more question. Is there a way for aliens to become citizens on Erra?
Yes. There is a way for aliens to become citizens. We have several Yahyel, Lyran, Fendorians, and many different species of citizens on Erra. Erra is one of the open arms of the Pleiades.
This will be my final one. Are there human Pleiadians in the Pleiades system?
You mean hybrids, or is that what you're speaking of?
I'm just asking.
There are many. Due to the fact that humans have donated their DNA, and the hybridization program is still going, is still very alive with Girk Fitneer.
Oh, actually, I was speaking about regular humans, because I was told from a spiritual master that there are many humans, not just from Earth, but from other planets that are native to their planet.
Humans from other planets are there. Humans from your planet are very few. They were grandfathered in before your governments made some rules. But there are not that many from your planet. But there are some, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Kenjin. Jess is asking, I feel pulled towards Colorado once my health improves. Is this because of a portal there? I know I play a part in first contact, but I'm still uncovering the details as I heal.
Yes. There is a place in Colorado that will be one of the 12 places that was that I mentioned before about first contact. And the reason for this is because they have a great amount of military, underground military buildings and things there. And this will just deactivate that while they're making their statements. Perhaps this is why you are feeling this particular draw.
All right. I have a few more questions about contact, Kenjin, and I think everyone would benefit from this.
Very well.
So one of them was, so obviously different groups are interested in doing first contact, I mean, in terms of ETs.
Yes.
So the question becomes, is there such a thing as a particular federation or group being in charge of it, or because not everyone belongs to all federations or one particular federation, different groups will handle it in a different way?
Yes, that is a very good question. What has happened is this. Even though they meet as a conference with all different groups, there had to be some control. Galactic law now states they have added an amendment to the galactic law that no first contact will come before the galactic committee says so. So this is something within the last 2 years that has come about. And so no one without a threat, without being under the law or against the law, would dare to make contact at this point unless they were insectoid or reptilian, who disregard that the galactic law in the first place. But they do not want to make first contact anyway. They would rather just infiltrate quietly. So therefore, yes, there are many that would like to make first contact, but the galactic law is now that if they do that without their consent, they would be punished. I do not know what the punishment is, but I know that they have put that out there. So there are many that have been up in arms, so to speak, particular amendment, because they do not want to be governed by that particular group. So but they know that they will be reprimanded if they do. So there is a lot of discussion in many different ways about these things. It is much like government out here as it is on your planet. But out here, it is actually a little safer in some ways.
Okay, yeah, because there are so many groups out there, and all the different groups are saying they're going to do contact. You know, just like we have one here.
They can say whatever they want. They know that at this point they are not permitted yet. It is just not time yet. But they already know that it is not time yet. So they do not want to cause themselves a war. If they go too soon, it will cause the governments of your world to cause a war with whoever is in their thought process. So they have to make sure that they are within certain bounds of your planet's understanding, or else there will be a war.
Okay, so who determines what group will come first?
That is a very good question. And I think the answer will be, when the time comes, that group with the greatest amount of preparation and stability in many senses will be allowed to come.
Okay. Yeah, because with all due respect, I think, you know, from some of the things that I've seen from Girk Fitneer, I don't think they have what it takes to do first contact. I think there were only because there were many things that were meant to happen and never happened. And, you know, if you look at this in a matter of, you know, certain things need to get done, and nothing ever happened there. So,
well, that is because they made promises that your government refuted.
Right. I understand that. I believe many other things went on there. So, you know, I'll keep that.
There was many things, and there are many things with other species as well.
Correct.
You do not know what is going on galactically. Every civilization, there is none that are perfect. So do not judge them too harshly, because their alliance is much better than some others. Although I agree with you, many things that were promised has not happened, and there were times when it could, but it just did not occur.
Yeah, so it's not just that, you know. I just see it in a matter of, you know, if you say you can do something, then you need to be able to, and that if first contact is a huge job. I mean, this is going to be something very monumental. It's going to take a lot of cooperation and coordination from ETs and from humans. So,
and that is why they are getting together. The conference is actually a good thing. They are sharing ideas between all of them and getting ideas from each other. And this will strengthen the idea pool. Like I said, there are still 7 major ideas on the table. 4 have been considered to be or able to be done.
Right. Now,
and you see, one group at this point will not be in charge of this because there's too many involved in it at this point. So Girk Fitneer will not have the final say.
Okay, so how does the Council of Nine, do they have anything to do with contact?
Yes, they do.
Okay.
They are part of this. Yes, they are part of the idea pool and the suggestion pool. And actually, their energy understanding of what first contact should be is a little different than some of the other groups, because the Council of Nine energetically feels that there should be a statement before they come to the Earth, that everyone should know that there is, they want to let them know that they're coming and see the reaction first before they bring anyone there. But yet that would, there are positives and negatives to that.
Negative being what?
That it might cause riots and fear and things of this nature. But the positive is it could be just accepted as a positive, saying, here, we're letting you know ahead of time that we're coming. And that's what their thought process is, that if someone were to come to them, they would want to know ahead of time and be let them know when they're going to arrive.
Okay. Now, I've also seen a couple of times now that the Greys have planned doing like a fake alien invasion, which would ruin the plans for first contact.
Yes. Believe me, they have tried many times to thwart the progress of first contact, and they will always try. But we are actually a little bit ahead of them because there are so many watching them. There are so many watching every move that they make. At this point, they cannot do anything without being observed.
Okay. Now, in terms of who comes first, why can it be a group of different species, not just yells?
That is one of the plans on the table, that it would be an interspecies contact.
Yeah, because I think that might be beneficial.
It's like all the other plans, it has its positive and negative sides that people point out. And you know, there are so many opinions about what first contact should be like.
Yes.
From different species, that it can be very heated at times.
Yes. Okay, and then I have to also bring up this, and I don't know that there's any particular answer you could give me, but because I've been listening to a lot of things based on the John Podesta emails, and some of the questions that people have, reputable people, and one of the thing is how to know what the agenda is of the extraterrestrials. In other words, whether it's a service to self, service to other kind of thing. How do you know that?
How you don't know. The problem is when you say something, how do I know you're telling the truth? Right. How do you know anyone is telling the truth? You have to trust. And that is one of the major problems with first contact, is trust. You must understand that for first contact to be successful, you must trust what they say. How other are you going to know what is true? If they do not show you all their intentions up front, the kindness, the goodness, the love, still some people will say, yes, a con man can do the same thing. He can show you all his wonderful traits and then steal your money. But so are the aliens come here to show you all their good traits and then take over? No, that is not what they're here to do. But yet many will think that because of the negative news that they always receive from governments, movie theaters, and filmmakers, and all the negative publicity that's been given to off-world people.
Right, and some of the negative things that have happened to people with aliens, they everybody starts to think that all the aliens are that way. So that's why
question is so valid, because how is anyone going to know? There's no truth detector. You don't have a lie detector on the aliens when they come down. You're going to have to listen what they say, and you're either going to believe it or you're not.
Right. And that's, you know, part of the issue that I've heard several people address. I mean, you guys can read our minds and can read, you know, our energy and that kind of thing.
Not all species can read minds, and especially in a mass group. When you're looking at the Earth, no species can read every mind on Earth at the same time, or even within a few days. But so don't be concerned about that. That's not even part of any of the plans. It's ridiculous to try to read all the minds.
What they were addressing is that you can know ahead of, if you're meeting with a human, you can know ahead of time their intentions. It's a lot harder for a human to read an ET.
Yes, that is true. But it means it can mean only that you have to trust.
Okay. Now, would you look for certain particular things in line to know that?
Well, what would you look at? Body language, eye contact, different things on your planet between humans will tell you if people are telling the truth or if they are not. And sometimes if they use these things and are not true to them, that would mean that they are a sociopath or something of this nature. So you can still, with reading the signs, still be led astray. So it all comes back to trust.
Sure. Yeah, I know.
There is no way for them to give a gesture that will be fully accepted by every person.
Right. Exactly. And I know that has, you know, both sides to it, just like everything else. So it's a very difficult thing to answer.
Yes. Well, there is no real answer except for trust, because there will be those that will trust and they will be called foolish by those that do not trust.
Right.
And those that do trust will say that those that do not trust are skeptical. Or are sad because they understand where they are. However, who is right? You will not know unless time passes by and proof is given that they are trustworthy, or proof is given that they are not trustworthy.
Yeah, because part of the argument was to assume that they're not, which I don't agree with that. I think there has to be somewhere in the middle of the road where you are trusting, yet cautious with you know what it's being done and how it's being handled. And the last question on this, Kenjin, if I don't know if you could, from your perspective, how do you see this happening in the best possible way in terms of being a small group, big group? Should it be done worldwide? Should it be done, you know, just ships landing on isolated places? How do you perceive it?
I see that the only integral thing is that you should do it on a large scale, whether it be one giant ship or several small ships. It should be that everyone knows pretty much at the same time. They'll see it and be aware of it and hear the message in a unified way so that they can act in a unified way. This, I think, is integral. Now, that is not seen by all as the best way to go. They feel that perhaps it should be one landing, then the news should spread. But I do not know if that is good, because the story will change as it moves around the world, just as conversations change as you speak them out one to another.
Okay.
So what is the best way? That is being decided.
Yeah, I know.
But if one message comes to many places, then it cannot be said that one said something different than the other.
Okay. And in terms of the government.
Yes.
And because, as you said, you know, I see the benefit of it being mass, because I can, just from experience, we know governments have a tendency to want to take over. And I think that the people need to be just as involved on this as governments are, that you know, every one of the beings that are here right now, of the humans that are here, deserve to also be involved and know that this is happening.
This is one point of view that is very popular, but not embraced by all. But yes, I sort of agree with that point of view, that it should be a massive thing, but even though it's more frightening in some senses, it will soon be they will soon speak what they have to say and calm people down. At least that's the idea.
Excuse me, now, Jim? Mm-hmm. I think that personally it would be way more helpful if we were to see some realistic pictures of them before they were here. From what I understand and what I have seen other people describe, it's not something that we think it is. They don't look like we think they do, most of them.
Exactly.
And so we'll be scared just by the looks if we don't have some looks ahead of time.
Yes, it's Kenjin.
Yes, I am Kenjin. Jim is not here right now, but I did answer because I know what you meant. But yes, you are right. Kenjin. To see them would be more beneficial ahead of time. And if you look, you will see that there are many pictures around your internet of different aliens, Yahyels, Greys, Reptilians, Insectoids. There are many pictures around the internet. And they're going to become more popular.
Yeah, part of what
are they realistic, Kenjin? Can you answer that one?
Yes, for the most part, they are becoming much more realistic.
Yeah, I think part of what she's talking about is, you know, it would be good if there were actual pictures of extraterrestrials, so that in the mind of the people, they start getting comfortable with the actual image of what they look like, so that when they see it, there is no shock there. It is a familiar image in their heads.
We do put images on your internet, and whenever they are found by the government, they are removed. So we do not tell them when we put them there or where they are, but they're constantly looking for them. But we are putting more and more on there so that it will be harder for them to remove, and some will be even harder to find.
Okay. And on that note, I want to say, Kenjin, that, you know, I've noticed not just the leaks, but there's new programs about ETs.
Yes.
There's a new program that came out called, what is it called? Earthlinks, you know, or something like that. But there are new shows showing up. There's even ETs in commercials nowadays.
Yes. There are literally tens of thousands of groups of people joining together in ET groups at this point. They are becoming more popular. They're becoming more acceptable. Not everyone is in there, and some even church people go to these things because they realize that some of the things that they are being taught are bogus. But they will come to learn more about the ETs so they are informed about what is happening.
Okay. I believe Shaheen had a question.
Yes. Hi.
Hello.
Hi, Your Majesty. Yeah, good. I'm really pleased to meet you. Thank you.
Thank you. It is good to be.
Thank you. I have a question. I live in Australia. I'm wondering when is going to be the first contact in Australia, because we are so far away from other cities and countries.
I understand what you are saying. In Australia, there may be two sites. I am not sure. But the Aboriginal people that live there are aware of the aliens, and they will be, they are also in contact with aliens right now. Believe it or not, they're far more advanced than you think they are. And there may be two sites, one on each side of the continent for Australia, because there needs to be that kind of connection.
I see.
The Aboriginal people call you, the people around them, mutants, because they are pure human people and everyone else is not.
That's true. And is there any portals around Australia anyways?
Of course. Yeah. There's portals everywhere. In Australia, there are no less than 200 portals.
I see.
The most powerful ones are on the, you are on the West Coast, are you not?
Yeah, Melbourne.
Yes. Would that be the East Coast?
Yeah, that's, or the West Coast? Yeah, no, that'd be East, yes. That'd be East.
East Coast.
Yeah.
There, you are closer to the portholes than those in the West. The West Coast, the West Coast has fewer than the East Coast. Around Sydney, there's a very large one outside of the city.
I see. So with the contacts, I do wish it happened as soon as possible, because
yes,
it would be better for everyone.
And I believe it will benefit everyone, because the reason it will benefit everyone is because they will understand finally that A, aliens do exist, that they're positive, B, that they're positive, C, that they have a spiritual life. They will learn that aliens have a spiritual life.
That's true.
That is something that a lot of humans do not comprehend or believe.
Yeah. Is it possible I can contact with them somehow? I would love to see them.
You can try to contact with them at all times. They will contact you if they feel that you are someone that they need to speak to. If they do not feel that you are someone that they need to speak to, they may not contact you back. However, if you are aware of them, a positive person, and have a message for them, or they have a message for you, they will definitely be in contact with you.
Because sometimes I feel the presence around there. Like one time I was looking at the sky in the farm, and I saw like sort of like a mothership shape, so to speak. And yes, I was quite surprised. I was at the front farm in South Gippsland, in Victoria, Melbourne. And yes, I was like, oh, that's it. And then I saw, but there was no one around me to realize. So, yeah, I was by myself. So, yeah, I was wondering maybe is that is sign. But sometimes I feel like I've been watched over by different ships and stuff like that. So, yeah.
If you are someone that they are observing on a daily basis, the chances of them speaking to you are very high. Perhaps not at this moment, but they are planning to speak to you sometime in the future or near future. And it will be something that you will be able to recall.
Thank you so much.
You are welcome.
Your Majesty, thank you.
I can see one last question. Khan wanted to know if that picture looks anything like you.
I see that picture. There is some similarities. I do not look quite that human. The scales on my face would take away from the smoothness of the look. I look similar to that. My face shape is very similar to that. The eyes are good. I do not have eyebrows like that, but there is, the shape of the face is excellent, actually.
What about the nose?
I have some scaliness that's not portrayed there.
Okay. And the nose?
At least I can't see his eyes. Yes?
The nose is okay?
Let me see. These eyes are not the best.
Okay.
Yeah, the nose is, yes, the nose is all right, maybe even a little smaller.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Kenjin. I want to say, thank you for sharing with us. I felt this was important to get an update.
I hope the information that came through was good enough.
Yes. Yes, thank you. And if you have any other updates, please feel free to come and let us know if anything else should arise.
Well, thank you very much.
And we want to thank you for sharing your time. I know you're very busy.
One moment, please. There is someone here in the room that has mentioned my name. Do you have a question?
Sure.
Yes. Oh, thank you. Never mind. It was not a question.
Okay. All right. So on that note, I would like to say namaste and keep up the good work.
Thank you very much. I appreciate this time and your listening. I hope that the information that has come across will help you in some way to be less fearful of the coming first contact and be to let your governments know somehow that you are aware of aliens. I know that if you send them a letter, they probably will not respond, and they will probably just say, oh, here's another one that's letting us know. But the thing is, the more that you do let them know, the greater the chances of them are to bring us in.
Yes, and I know aliens can be very loving also, so.
Yes, of course.
Yeah. So I've experienced plenty of it. So I have to say, yeah, there are many, just like with us, there are people that are very positive, very good, and people that are not. It's the same thing. And I think so long as we use discernment with our choices and make intelligent choices, I think it will be fine, and that it is time for us to really join and become aware of what truly reality is and what the truth is, and that you guys have been with us pretty much since the beginning.
Of course. I wanted to say one thing before I left.
Go ahead.
Khan, you're an excellent artist. I enjoy what you have drawn. Sometimes your characters seem a little too human sometimes, because sometimes some of us are a little less human, but you are a wonderful artist and I appreciate what you are doing.
Yes. Yes, he's wonderful.
I love him. He is. You made me look better than I really look.
He is great. He is great. He can draw in 10 seconds. So we love him here.
Yes, very well.
Very well. Thank you, Kenjin.
You are welcome.
We appreciate you. And.
But he's also your dear boss, aren't you?
Namaste.
Goodbye, Majesty.
Good day.
Good day.
Would you like to bring someone else?
No, we want Jim.
Yes, I will bring him back then. Hello. Hi.
Hello.
Hey, how's everybody doing?
Very good.
Excellent. Oh, I need some real water. Is everybody doing all right?
Yes.
Awesome. Thank you, Jim.
Everybody's doing really good. So, Jim.
Yes.
So, let me tell you what the surprise is.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, you've been doing this for us for a long time, and you've been very giving, and I know you were going through a rough time, you know, rightly so, with what happened with your father.
Yes.
So,
I was struggling a lot.
Yeah, it was very, very difficult. So it occurred to me that we would do a few minutes of appreciation for you. So many people have prepared a message for you.
Oh.
And we would like to say it or speak it or read it. You know, I'll be reading some.
Dang
so,
it.
Yes, because, you know, I think it would help you, would cheer you up, give, you know, lift up your spirits.
Well, thank you so much. That's so kind of you. So many of you have already sent so many nice and kind things to me. I appreciate it so much. I feel that so many of you are just so good and loving people. I just thank you so much for that. I appreciate it so much.
Yeah. So on that note, Valerie would like to go first.
Thank you.
So I will let Valerie speak first.
Thank you so much, Jim. Jim, I just want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for being a strong role model that I could look up to and welcome me to your family. I found you on the YouTube, and that has quite literally changed my life for the better.
Thank you.
Jim, you have helped me become a better person with an open mind. You have also helped me reach master in Reiki healing that I have wanted for a very long time. It is my pleasure to pay it forward every day in sending healing energy out 2 times a day, morning and evening, to all those who are in need. I do this with you in mind every time.
Well,
you have no idea how much you have helped me in my life. You've helped my relationship. You've helped me to find new friends that I love and trust dearly that are here in your family. I love your spirit, every bit of it. Every time I see your face, you make me smile. You lift my vibration, and my hope is that I do just a little of that for you too. So thank you, Jim. I love you.
I love you too. Thank you very much. I'm so undeserving of that kind of praise. I just feel like I'm being used the way God wants me to be used. And thank you so much for saying those kind things. That's beautiful. I'm glad. I'm so, so very glad you're being helped. And I love you very much. Thank you so much.
No, the thanks is for you, Jim.
Thanks.
Jim, from me and from Nivi, we just wanted to let you know that you're so much appreciated. You help me, my family, my friends, everyone around me knows you and asking about you. And there's so much love around you. And there's so many people already in Israel that heard about the amazing Jim. And I'm sure that God sent you here. It's definitely. And I already told you that you're so much loved. And I don't know if you can even comprehend how much we love you, because you are so dear to us. And I'm just so glad and so grateful that we know you and that you're in our life. And we get to see you and we get to speak with you. And every day I'm sending you hugs and prayers, and hopefully one day I'm going to see you in person and give you such a huge hug. And you are welcome here in Israel. Anyone here in Hucolo is welcome. And just, I can't even pronounce how much we love you here. So thank you for everything you do. And we so love you.
Oh, well, thank you so much. I so love you as well. I have such a good connection with you and your brother, Nivi, and the people of Israel have been so beautiful. Thank you so much for that beautiful, I don't even know, I'm speechless. I don't know what to say. Thank you. I love you too.
We want you to be happy.
Well, thank you. And I'm very happy.
Okay, so I will now read, let's see. Okay, so Jody, which you have not met her, but she told me to say, please tell Jim, even though he does not know me, I watch all the time, and he has brought much joy and love and awesome helpful information to her. I send much love and appreciation to Jim.
Thank you.
That was Jody. Now, Akan wrote this. So he says, there is much separation on this earth. There's much information, everything, and it looks like an infinity. And he felt lost, so lost and alone. And uncomfortable with knowledge and without knowledge, because there was no emotions, because there was no human touch, because there was no good reason to follow the path. Jim, you created a human soul bridge for accessing the galactic knowledge. Galactic knowledge is easy to access everywhere, but understanding as a human is hard. You make their message and ideas more easy to understand and get it all. Because of your heart, you create this energy and mix it. I met awesome people because of you. I met beautiful ETs because of your energy. I got a goal now. I don't feel alone anymore. You made us one, and we are one connected with each other. Whenever I feel down, I listen to your channeling randomly. I love your connection, your voice, and your human part. I have no more fears. I have no more worries. You give me courage, and my life is so different. You are a chance for us, and I thank you for sharing your soul. We are here for mostly human warmth heart. People grow when their father died, sad on Turkish authors' books. It's hard because without him, life, it's not complete. We are here with you, and we are here to help you. I am grateful to have met you. I know you and listen to you. Much love, Khan.
Thank you, Khan. That was beautiful. Thank you so much. I love you as well. And you're so gifted and talented. I appreciate who you are. And that you're giving your gifts to the world. That's beautiful. Thank you.
Okay.
I love it.
So now, Limey. My love and appreciation always to what I know as one of the dearest friends. You have brought much light into my life and much hope. I can't thank you enough from where I am over here. You are there. I am over where you are. I thank you for all the wonderful beings you bring through. I thank you for all the time you gave and you give yourself up for the spirit friends. We are all unique and special, but some more than others. My heartiest thank you to you always. I hope my message sees you in a good health and happy and loving spirit. My many blessings to you, and now for the future, much love, Jim, and hope to speak to you soon.
Oh, thank you, Liney. I love you so much. we have a special connection, and I love who you are and your kids and everything. So thank you so much. I love you so much.
If anyone in the room wish to speak or say anything to Jim, please do. I'll leave myself for last. Or in the room with Jim. Go ahead, yeah. Angie.
Oh, no, I can't do this.
Jim, what you have brought to humanity and raising everybody's vibration and bringing your love and your light, helping people move forward, just is beyond words. And your service that you have and that you are doing right now, people, humanity, are moving forward because of you.
Thank you very much. I love you very much.
I love you.
Thank you so much. I get it. I don't know what to say.
It's okay. Anybody else wish to speak?
Hey, Angie. Angie, can you give Jim a hug for me and a kiss? This has been Brian. Give him a
thank
kiss.
You, Brian. I appreciate that so much.
Oh, you're
I appreciate that so much. Thanks.
All this love to soak in, Jim.
Yes, thank you. I appreciate it so much. I never realized. I mean, I love bringing the messages from others to you, and I feel very blessed to be in this position, to be able to be a channel. So, thank you.
We love you.
Thank you. Nice. Thank you. I just feel very blessed to be able to do this.
Yes. Go ahead, this Brian. Work.
Yes, I wanted to expand on that. I have a message here for you, Jim. Is that okay?
Yes. Oh, that's right.
Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can hear you fine.
All right. To greatest Jim, we are your friends. We have always been around you. You've known us for a long time. This is a channel transmission right now. We know who you are. We've been with you for a long time. We are the angels around you. We keep you warm. We keep comfort to you. We are that we are. All that we are, you are. We love you very much, my friend. And so it is. Namaste.
Hey, thanks so much. Beautiful.
Gabriel, would you like to say something?
Yeah. Thank you for teaching me the languages like
oh, Gabriel. It's so good to see you.
And for bringing my teacher, she was amazing.
Amazing. I love you, Gabriel, and I will talk to you soon. Things have been so crazy.
Jim, how are you?
Good. How are you? Thank you so much.
Go ahead, Chris.
Yeah, Jim, again, I'm at a loss for words, to be honest with you, over your loss. But please accept my sincere condolence. You're in my thoughts. And as I say that, there was an English comedian called Spike Milligan. I don't know whether you ever came across him or not. He died in the early, I think he died in 2002. But he put an inscription on his gravestone, and basically what it said was, I told you as I was sick.
Just cut that. You cut off.
Yeah. Thank you, Jim. Enjoy your evening.
I love you, Christopher. I really do. Thank you so much for all you do.
No problem.
Okay. Does anybody else wish to say any words to Jim?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Hi, Jim. This is David.
Hi, David.
Having trouble speaking. Thank you for saving.
Baby, you're gonna make me cry.
Yeah.
He's just trying to say what we all feel.
Thank you for saving my life, as you know. Thank you. You know what happened. Thank you for saving my life.
Thank you, Jim, for saving his life.
Okay.
I can't speak anymore.
All right. I want to say a few words now, seeing that I'm going to have to go soon, but I want to say this. Jim, you know, I joined Hucolo because I had a question about some language that I was speaking. I didn't expect to find what I found when I met you guys. And it was these two guys that were curious, were wanting to know more, were being open to all these new things. And you took it in strides. You allowed it to happen. You allow yourself to be shared with us. At no moment did you ever question it. Did you ever say, I'm not going to do this. What is this? That this is not my life. you didn't do any of those things. You kept on going and you kept on sharing and you kept on giving with us. And all this time, with every person that has come through here, you have tried to give them the best of you and to share your time, even at times when people didn't have the money to share, to give, you share regardless. And that is very rare. And I commend you for that. I commend you for the heart that you have. And I want you to know that your father did a wonderful job and that it right now he's watching, he knows that the son that he brought up was great and that he did a great job and that you're a wonderful person and that you have taught all of us how to be giving, how to be loving, how to even in the middle of a storm to stand still and love, to let go, and to be all those things that are possible in humanity. So when you think of your father, and I'm sure as your father watches you, now he sees all the love that you have shared with others, and he would see that you are loved and you love others, that it's not just a channeling group, but it's a community that has learned to love and appreciate you and that has stood by you and you have stood by us. And on the personal level, I have to say that, you know, I have crossed many storms. And you have been there for me. And, you know, I don't want to cry. As difficult as it has been, I have to say, you know, you've been very good to me. And I really appreciate that from the bottom of my heart. And, you know, that's why I chose to always stand by you, because I knew the cause was worthy, and I knew you were worthy. Otherwise, I would not have been here. So know that, you know, I do this because I know your heart. I know you mean what you say. And though at times things get hard, you are a kind, loving human being that chooses to share with all of us whatever gift he has. So thank you, Jim, for all of that. And thank you for loving all of us. Jim.
Thank you so much, Sabrina. I love you very much. I love you all. Thank you so much. This is like, I don't have words to explain how I feel right now.
So Mark might
cry anymore.
Mark might have some words for you too. So Mark, did you want to go next?
Sure. You know, I haven't known Jim that long, but in the last year he's become one of my best friends. And I think at the beginning of every webinar, when you see his face light up as he sees all of his friends pop in, that excitement, that genuine joy in connecting with people and caring about them is one of the most beautiful aspects of Jim that I've had the pleasure of witnessing as I've gotten to know him. And he has my love and admiration.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you.
I love you, Mark.
Thank you too, Jim.
So on that note, Sam, did you want to say something? Maybe he can't talk.
Speaking, so I just type. But I want to say thank you, Jim. We love you.
Love you too.
Okay.
Jim, so, you are the glue that holds this family together.
So, Jim, I hope, you know, this helps your heart see how much you're appreciated and loved. And
oh my God.
You lost your father. Know that you have all of us on your side pulling for you.
Thank you.
And that we will all be here with you in your moments of sadness and happiness, because, you know, that's what a true family does. They stand together regardless of what is.
Well, you are my family. I love you all. And I hope that I've been able to help as much as possible any of you and all of you. It's a blessing to be able to do this. And I don't know what to say. But thank you very much.
All right. Thank you. On that note, I will be closing the webinar. So thank you all that watched and participated and listened and joined and laughed and cried and shared here. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Sabrina, for giving us this opportunity to let Jim know how important he is to our family.
Well, it's overwhelming. It's overwhelming.
Yes.
Overwhelming.
Yes.
I'm overwhelmed.